recreated this scene from Avatar, The Way of Water in Blender. Every model, simulation, and animation used to recreate the scene in Blender was made entirely from scratch. Let's start with the models, and there were quite a few. I began with a train. Since it's at the center of most shots, I wanted it to look as realistic and faithful to the original as possible. I modeled it by creating smaller components separately, and assembling them into the final shape. This allowed me to create a highly accurate replica of the original train. Texturing was a very important step. I had to make sure the surfaces looked realistic. The key was to avoid overly clean surfaces. Using noise and wave textures, and shader mixing, I created scratches, chip paint, rust, and dents on the train model. These imperfections added a lot of realism. I hand-painted the stripes on the front of the train, using the texture paint mode in Blender. Next, I move on to the wagons. That step went a bit faster. To stay true to the original scene, I made several different types of wagons. Then came the drones. I approached their material similarly to the train, focusing on imperfections that make them feel more real. Next up, the tracks. I created only a short section of rails, and used two modifiers, array and curve, to duplicate and bend them. The array modifier duplicates the rail segment in a straight line, and curve bends it along a curve. That same curve later served as the path for the train's movement, but we'll come back to animation in a moment. I created the plants a bit differently. First, I photographed real leaves and plants I found outside. These photos became my textures. Then I modeled the plants based on those photos. To make tree trunks, I used the skin and subdivision surface modifiers. It's a very fast and easy way to model a tree. Here's how. I added a cube, entered edit mode, pressed A, then M, and chose its center. Then I added the skin and subdivision surface modifiers. I used E to extrude the vertices into the shape of a tree. With Command plus A on Mac, or Control plus A on Windows, I adjusted the thickness of the skin modifier. I recommend enabling proportional editing and adding an extra subdivision surface modifier before the skin. It helps achieve a more organic look. I also tried 3D scanning for the first time. I used just my phone camera to scan real objects from the forest. These scans became part of the scene as well, and this method has major advantages. Most importantly, the scanned objects look realistic and come with textures already applied. Once I had the models, I assembled the scene in one Blender file. Animating the train required careful planning from the start. To make the movement look realistic, I had to pay close attention to scale and speed. In my first attempt, the train moved too slowly. Even with good render settings and motion blur enabled, the effect didn't look real. It felt more like a video game scene. Even though I adjusted the motion blur for my frame rate initially 30 frames per second, the train still moved too slowly physically, so it didn't sell the illusion. In my updated version, I made sure the scale and timing were correct. The train moves along a curve using the curve modifier. The drones fly along copied curves, with small edits, since they change direction slightly at the end. The camera follows the train's position using the copy location constraint. I also added a noise modifier in the graph editor to create slight handheld camera shake. This small imperfection adds a lot of realism. The next shot features an explosion. Simulating explosions in Blender is not easy. Finding the ideal domain settings often takes a lot of trial and error, and that was definitely the case here. I don't even remember how many times I recalculated the simulation while tweaking the settings. Eventually, I got a result I was happy with. The key settings are shown on screen. The flow objects, the ones emitting smoke and fire, used particle systems. To shape the explosion in Blender, particle systems are usually the best way. You basically want to form a shape similar to what you're seeing now. I use shape keys, so the ground deforms in reaction to the shockwave. It's easy to do. Add two shape keys, edit the second one in edit mode to deform the ground, and then animate the value. I also added a shockwave sphere, just a regular sphere with a slightly glowing material. It's a simple scale animation, and I also animated the material to make it fade out. It only appears for a few frames, but adds a lot of impact. During the explosion, I added camera shake again, which really enhances the scene. You can also see sparks flying as the train breaks. I created those using particle systems. The third shot shows the same explosion from a different perspective. This time, the camera has different settings. I changed the focal length, which makes the scene feel like it's being filmed from farther away. In this shot, I had no choice but to animate the drone by hand. It took some time, but I managed to recreate the motion fairly well. I also had to animate this thing, and technically, I should have used rigid body simulations, but that would have taken too long, so I just animated it manually. Then I added particles and used shape keys to deform the object as it hit the tracks. The effect isn't perfect, but it works well enough, since it's not the main focus of the shot. In this shot, the sun shines from a different direction than in the previous ones. That's not a mistake, it's actually a common cinematic trick to make lighting more visually appealing. Changing the light angle can prevent the explosion from looking flat and adds depth to the scene. Here I show a comparison between lighting from earlier shots and the new lighting. You can immediately see which version looks better. Another point worth mentioning is the explosion timing. In this shot, we don't see a direct continuation of the previous explosion. It almost looks like the explosion restarts. That's intentional. It's a common editing trick to make a short explosion appear longer on screen. The fourth shot is a close-up of the train right after the explosion. I added another fire simulation here. The domain was much smaller and less demanding. I used the deformed object as the flow source to make the fire more chaotic. I also added the train as an effector, so the fire reacts to its motion. Besides fire, I added a particle system to simulate sparks and small flying debris from the tracks. In the next two shots, some wagons crashed into the ground. I approached these scenes more quickly. In fact, in my second version, I didn't even try to polish them further. I used rigid body simulations and some basic deformations to create the impact. They're not physically perfect, but from the right camera angle, they look good enough. I simply didn't have the time or energy to spend another week refining those shots. All shots were rendered in cycles, with motion blur and denoising enabled at 24 frames per second. In some scenes, I had to lower the quality of the smoke and fire to keep render times reasonable. The average render time per frame was around 10 minutes on my Mac Studio with M1 Max. In the compositor, I added effects like glow and lens distortion. As you can see, I used a lot of nodes to achieve the best possible result. I also tried to adjust the colors, though I'm still learning color grading, so it's not perfect yet. During production, I ran into a few problems. Early on, the train was moving too slowly, so the motion blur looked fake. Even with good settings for 30 frames per second, the scene just didn't look right. Worst of all, fixing it meant reanimating almost everything. I also had to stretch the track model to better match the new speed. Spending time to fix that was totally worth it. The difference is huge. Another issue is with textures. Everything looked too clean, sterile, and plastic. I reduced color saturation and added more imperfections. I introduced extra roughness maps and dirt textures to break up smooth surfaces. The final result looked way better. Simulating the explosion was also challenging. It took a very long time to get it right. After many adjustments to the settings, I finally achieved a result I was satisfied with. And now, the final result. I've also included my first attempt and the improved version for comparison.